Well, Lord, we come before you humbly this morning, and we are here to worship you in this place, God. We're here to lift your name on high. Lord, we are here to sing your praises, God. I pray that as we worship you in this place, Lord, that your spirit would fall heavy, Lord, that the weight of your glory would fall heavy in this place, God, as we declare your praises, as we sing of your name, of your deeds, of who you are, Lord. We are here for you, God. I pray that you would come and visit heavy in this place this morning, Lord. It's in Jesus' mighty, holy name that we pray. Amen. Would you please stand and join us as we worship this morning?
Speak against my borrowed innocence. The judge is my defense. I'm going free. Right when the gavel fell, I heard the freedom bell ring through the heart of hell. I'm going free. I'm going free. Sing glory. Glory, glory, hallelujah. You threw my shackles in the sea. Oh, glory, glory, hallelujah. Jesus is my liberty. I'm going free. Yes, I'm going free. I won't go back again. That's just not who I am. Lord, I'm a brand new man. I'm going free. I'm on a narrow road. It's paved with grace and hope. It's gonna lead me home. I'm going free. I'm going free.
Sing it out, glory.
Oh, glory, glory, hallelujah. You threw my shackles in the sea. Oh, glory, glory, hallelujah. Jesus is my lift.
Sing it again.
Oh, glory, glory, hallelujah. You threw my shackles in the sea. Oh, glory, glory, hallelujah. Jesus is my liberty. I'm going free. Yes, I am free. I'm free indeed. Yes, I am. We are free indeed. Yes, we are free. We are free indeed. Yeah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. You threw my shackles in the sea. Oh, glory, glory, hallelujah. Jesus is my liberty. Oh, glory, glory, hallelujah. You threw my shackles in the sea. Oh, glory, glory, hallelujah. Jesus is my liberty. I'm going free. Yes, I'm going free. Someday I'll fly, oh, on your amazing grace. Your love is my jailbreak. I'm going free. I'm going free.
Amen, Lord. Yes, Lord, we are free in you, Lord.
That you shed your blood, so I'm gonna live like my shame is gone. I won't be shackled to the way I was. No, I'm gonna live like my chains are gone, gone. Now my sin is dead and gone, and I sing hallelujah. shout like the battle's won. Yeah, fall back, devil, cause your time is up. So I'm gonna live like the stone is gone, gone. Now my sin is dead and gone, and I sing hallelujah. It is done, done. Done, and I sing hallelujah.
Sing it again, gone.
Oh, gone, gone. Now my sin is dead and gone, and I sing hallelujah. Done, done. And he is risen, it is done, and I sing hallelujah. The power of the blood. Whoa, 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 whoa. I am the righteousness of God. Whoa, 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 whoa. How great the power of the blood. And I sing hallelujah. Gone, gone. Now my sin is dead and gone. And I sing hallelujah. It is done, done. And he is risen, it is done. And I sing hallelujah.
Praise in this place this morning, Lord. Lord, that while we were your enemies, Lord, you sent your son to die in our place, God. That we're here to sing your praises this morning, Lord. Lord, we love you. Lord, we surrender it all to you, God. The name above all names, the King above all kings, Lord. We worship you this morning. Hallelujah. That's what we sing, Lord. Hallelujah.
Of the Son of Man, stories of a Savior, and holiness with human hands, and treasure for the traitor. No ear has heard, no eye has seen. The image of the Father, until heaven came to live with me, a rescue like no other. Yes, you are worthy. You are worthy of your name. You are worthy. You are worthy of your name, Jesus. You are worthy, Lord.
Did not speak.
You did not speak, you made no sound. You died for your accusers. And as your blood fell to the ground, you redefined my future. And And on the day that you arose, the darkness ran for cover. For the King of Kings has claimed his throne.
you can do, oh God of wonders. Your power has no end. The things you've done before in greater measure, you will do again. 'Cause there's no prison, no wall you can't break through, no mountain you can't move, all things are possible. There's no broken body you can't raise, no soul that you can't save, all things are possible. The darkest night, you can light it up, you can light it up. Oh God of revival, let hope arise, death is overcome. You've already won, oh God of revival, God of revival. You rose in victory, and now you're seated forever on the throne. Why should my heart fear what you defeated? I will trust in you alone. 'Cause there's no prison, no wall you can't break through, no mountain you can't move, all things are possible.
There's no broken body,
there's no broken body you can't raise, no soul that you can't save, all things are possible. The darkest night, you can light it up, you can light it up. Oh God of revival, let hope arise, death is overcome. You've already won, oh God of revival. Stronghold will crumble. I hear the chains hit the ground. Oh God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. Come awaken your people, come awaken the city. Oh God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. Every stronghold will crumble. I hear the chains hit the ground. Of revival, pour it out. The darkest night, you can light it up, you can light it up. Oh God of revival, let hope arise, death is overcome. You've already won, oh God of revival.
In 2 Chronicles 7:14, it says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, and they turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. Lord, we remind you of your prayer this morning, your promise. Lord, that's our prayer this morning, that you would come and you would heal our land. Lord, that you would revive the souls, God. That you would awaken the city. You would awaken the lost, God. You revive our souls, God. Let your fire fall, Lord. Let's sing it out, church. Come awaken.
Come awaken your people. Come awaken the city. Oh, God.
God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. Every stronghold will crumble, and I hear the chains hit the ground.
Let's turn this morning to 2 Kings chapter 6. As we prepare to take the tithes and offerings, I want to share some things with you this morning. I'm really bad about telling people how to give, right? So Bev will put something up so you know how to do that. The basket's over here. You can go online. Just go to DesertCreekFellowship.com. At the very bottom of the page, there's online giving. It'll have all the information there for you. So, 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 1. The company of the prophets said to Elisha, "Look, the place we are meeting with you is too small for us. Let us go to the Jordan, where each of us can cut a pole, and let us build a place there for us to meet." And he said, "Go." Then one of them said, "Won't you please come with your servants?" "And I will," Elisha replied. And he went with them. And they went to the Jordan, they began to cut down trees. And as one of them was cutting down a tree, the iron axe head fell into the water. "Oh no, my Lord," he cried out. "It was borrowed." The man of God asked, "Where did it fall?" And when he showed him the place, Elisha cut a stick and threw it in there and made the iron float. "Lift it out," he said, and the man reached out his hand and took it. I know I come back to this passage a lot, and I know I ask the same rhetorical question a lot. What unique property does a stick have that makes iron float? What was the magic thing that throwing that stick in the water did that caused the iron? I mean, I don't know if you're familiar with the Jordan. The Jordan is not a clean stream, right? It's a muddy mess. And you drop iron in there, it's going to go down, it's going to hit that silt and that mud at the bottom. And so Elisha cuts a stick, throws it in the water, and it floats. Do you suppose that was the stick that caused that to happen? Okay, you're chuckling. The obvious answer is no, it's not a stick that causes that to happen. The truth is, the stick had absolutely nothing to do in the natural realm with the axe head floating. What the prophet has done is what we today call a prophetic action. We do something in the natural realm that speaks toward our faith. It's a way of us to express our faith. I believe, and therefore I might act accordingly. I will do something in accordance with what I believe. James would say it like this. In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by your action, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by what I do or by my deeds. James 2:17 through 18. Sometimes what happens in our lives is we need to take a natural step to augment the thing that we are believing God for. We step out with an action that corresponds with our faith. And today I want to give you an example. When we first started the church, we had a guitar player, we had a singer. We desperately needed a bass player. I mean, for me, we needed a bass player, right? It just sounded so flat and so light and thin. And okay, we were doing all right without one. But we got one now and it's much better, isn't it? Right? Just that nice bottom in there. Now, what I begin to do is I begin to ask the Lord to send somebody to join us who could be part of us, who would have our heart and our call and share all the things that we as a people are, but could also play the bass, right? Looking for that special piece. And so part of the action that I took as I begin to believe God for that is I bought a bass. Hung it right there on the wall. Why'd you do that? You don't have a bass player. Nope. Sometimes people would come in and they'd say, hey, when did we get a bass player? It's like, I don't know, but soon. Do you understand? I was taking action based on what I was doing, what I was believing God for. Now, when our bass player joined us, she came with her own bass. Well, that would be expected. Most people play their own instruments. So I didn't take it down because for me it became a symbol or a trophy, if you'll allow me to be so crass, of a faith project that was complete. I saw it as God moving on our behalf. It's a reminder to me of God's faithfulness. Now, let's just be honest. We don't need a bass player. Truth is, we don't even need a worship team. Do you understand? There are churches all over the world today that have gathered and they're singing outside a cappella, on key, off key, in time, out of time, all over the place, and somebody brought a tambourine. And you know what? It's a joyful noise unto the Lord, and He loves it, and it's special to Him. So we don't need those things. But I also want you to understand that He delights in giving those things to us. You need to understand that. God is not, He's not stingy like that. He wants to give these things to His people, especially when your desires are rightly focused. Didn't want a bass player. Well, I wanted it to sound good, but I really wanted to worship the Lord in a better way. Do you understand? The heart focus is right. It's proper. So, it dawned on me, I was talking with Bev, and most people wouldn't know why the bass is hanging there. And it actually seems a little silly for a bass to be hanging on the wall. So I just thought I would let you know what the bass hanging on the wall is about. Now, the truth is, it's probably time for us to take the bass down. I mean, it's just kind of gathering dust now. But I don't want to take it down until we come up with another faith project as a church. Something else we're going to believe God for, and we'll put it in that place. And we'll see it, and we'll remember it, and we'll ask God, and we'll thank God, and we'll pray. I want to find something we can all get behind. Now, the reason I'm sharing this with you today, well, first off, I want you to know why a bass is hanging on the wall. But second, I want you to understand that in your life, right now today, you may actually need a prophetic action to break through in your own life. There may be something you need to do in your own life to take the next step into the next place. Maybe you need to spend some time considering, is there something I could do in the natural that will help the breakthrough come in the spiritual? Something to seal the deal, as it were. People do different things. A friend of mine was getting ready to buy a house, and believe it, he didn't have the money for a house. Just didn't have the money. He was believing God for the money, and he believed, and he believed. And you know what he did? He went out and bought a doormat. That's weird. It wasn't weird. He took the doormat and he put it at the front of the house he was renting. And every time he came in, I'm going to have a house. God's going to give me a house. Every time he left, my house is on its way. And when he got his house, he put his doormat at his new house. I hope you understand. They are points of faith for us to connect with, and they become important. Sometimes the greatest act of faith that you can make is to meet somebody else's need that's in the same vein. So, I'll tell you one of the things we did. You know, we weren't always out of debt, right? Everybody has troubles from time to time. And as we were getting out of credit card debt, I started seeking out friends. Now, they had to be close friends. I'm going to go around and ask everybody, hey, how much credit card debt do you have? But as we were talking with friends, people would say things like, we are so close to being out of credit card debt. And I'd say, how much is it? And I will write you a check. I want to see you out of debt. And I don't know if you understand, for me, that was my prophetic action. But not only was it a prophetic action, I was also sowing and reaping at the same time. Kind of the 1-2 punch. When we were believing God to see our house paid off, I was looking for somebody who didn't know a whole lot on their house so I could write them a check. I just want you to understand, whatever friends you're believing God for, and as His church, as His people, you should in your life have a faith project of some sort. You should be believing Him, trusting Him for something that's outside your ability. And whatever that something is, friend, today you may need to cut a stick and throw it in the water. You understand what I mean by that? Cut a stick and throw it in the water, because sometimes that's what it takes for the breakthrough to come. Father, I bless your people today. Father, thank you for them. Father, I pray that you would anoint this house. Father, I pray that you would cause, Father, prosperity to dwell here in Jesus' name. Father, so that we would be that we would have enough that we could be a blessing on every occasion. Father, I pray that debt would be eradicated from this house. Father, I'm asking you to remove debt from this house. Father, make us a people free. No more being servants to the lenders. And Father, I pray that you would help us to be good stewards of the things that you have given us, Father, so that, like the Good Samaritan, we could be a blessing on every occasion. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm already out of time. So I'm just going to dive right in this morning. There's a couple things I want to share with you real quick. Let's turn this morning to Luke chapter 16, verse 16. Now, you're going to need to stick with me this morning. God's been speaking a lot of things to me. If you read the newsletter this week, God has been speaking to me about the need for His people to have peace. We are a people, God has made a way for us to have peace. We need to step into the peace that God has for us. We also, this morning, Amy's going to share a prophecy that God has given her, and it's. I want to give you a little bit of direction before we get there. So Luke 16, 16. Now, this morning, I'm going to read from the New Living Translation, specifically because it brings clarity to what is being said, and I think it's important. So Luke 16, 16. until John the Baptist, the law of Moses, and the messages of the prophets were your guides. But now the good news of the kingdom of God is preached, and everyone is eager to get in. Let's pray. Father, help me today to share your word with your people. Father, help Amy today to share the word that you've given her. Father, help us to step into the things that you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen. So the law and the prophets were until John the Baptist. That is how God led his church up to that point. This is Jesus speaking. I'm not making this stuff up. I gave you the reference. You need to look at it. I think this morning it's important, especially in light of prophecy and especially in light of all the things that are going on in the world, I think I need to add some clarification so you understand how a New Testament prophet is supposed to operate. What Jesus has said was the law and the prophets, that's the Old Testament prophets, were until John. That meant that there was going to be a change. And we know there was a change to the law, right? We've all stepped into a new covenant. The prophets also changed. How they operated and what they did changed. Jesus was very clear in this passage. The law and the prophets, up until John, were the guide for the church. They are what led, well, the synagogue. They are what led God's people, let me say it that way. But after John, that was all going to change. See, after John, the kingdom of God has now been preached. Christ has completed his work on the cross. He's ascended into heaven, and his body, that's us, we're going to receive a new guide. This should sound somewhat familiar to you. You should be going, wow, really? When did that happen? This is the Comforter he spoke about, the Paraclete, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is now the guide for the church. It's no longer the law and the prophets. They were until John. Going forward, there was going to be a new guide for God's people. This is the way God intends to lead his church going forward. In John chapter 14, verse 26, Jesus says this. He says, "All this I have spoken while still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you." He's going to be your new guide, is what he's saying. He will lead you into all things. And then just a couple of pages over in chapter 16, verse 12, Jesus will continue. "I have much more to say to you, more than you can now bear." I can't give you all this stuff now because it'd simply crush you. "When he comes, the guide, he will lead you into all truth, and he will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears. He will tell you what is yet to come, and he will glorify me, because it is from me that he will receive what he will make known to you. All that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said the Spirit will, receive from me what he will make known to you." The Spirit is what makes known our path and direction. He becomes our guide. The Apostle John, as he wrote his first epistle, he would say it this way, 1 John chapter 2, verse 27, "But you have received the Holy Spirit, and he lives in you, so you don't need anyone to teach you what is true. For the Spirit teaches you everything you need to know, and what he teaches is true, it's not a lie, so that just as he has taught you, remain in fellowship with Christ." I need to bring these things up today because one of the things that we're seeing in the world today is we're seeing the church follow prophets. Prophets are not meant to be our guide. The Holy Spirit is meant to be our guide. In the Old Testament, the law and the prophets were the guide of Israel. It doesn't work that way anymore unless you're actually part of Israel and you're under that old covenant. This is now the job of the Holy Spirit. So the purpose of the prophet in the New Testament is a little bit different. The purpose of the prophet in the New Testament is to build up and lift up and to encourage. That's what their job is. Sometimes what happens is they come and they encourage, they have a word, they lift me up, they build me up, and I start following them. Okay, well, that's error, right? Hear the word, receive the word, and then weigh it against the written word. Do you understand what I'm telling you? This is why sometimes the church has gotten a little bit sideways, right? Because a good word comes, but they start following the prophet instead of following the one who gave the prophet the word, right? I appreciate the prophets, and you need to understand something. We need the prophets. God left us the prophets. He raises up prophets even today for the encouragement, the lifting up, and the building up of his body. That's what they do. Now, I'm bringing this up largely because Amy had sent me a word, a month ago almost now. And it's a good word, and it's encouraging for the body. And there are directive points in it. But this is how prophecy works. I want this word to be shared with you. And I want you, see, sometimes what happens, I'm just being honest with you, a woman is bringing. Oh my goodness, well, we can't receive that then. No, that's not how this works. Sometimes it's like, well, she isn't ordained. Can she do that? Yes, she can. I want to lay some paths so you can all receive the word that is coming. Man, I don't understand why. I just work here. For whatever reason, God has brought many very prophetic people to our church. They're very prophetic. They have insights and wisdom and understanding that go. Sometimes you'll find one or two prophetic people in a very large body. We have many in a very small body. My desire is to nurture and encourage and help that prophetic gift grow. Because, see, the thing is, God raises up prophets because we need the prophets. And right now, the church is very busy removing all these things from the church. I don't want to do that. And so I want you to be able to receive this word. As we grow up in the prophetic and in all the other gifts of the Spirit, as these things begin to manifest on a more regular basis in our meetings, we need to understand we're not following the prophets, following the Holy Spirit. But what the prophet does, it's like, you know, when I was a kid, Dad always handed me a flashlight when he was working on the truck. Shine this here. He just needed a little more. He knew what he was doing. He knew where things were split. He just needed a little more light. Prophets bring light. Dad's always said, move the light, move the light. You're moving the light. Well, that's because we're all imperfect in many ways. Prophecy is a vital part of the New Testament church. And there's too many churches that are removing the prophetic from their churches because what happens is people get hurt. A word comes and it causes division or trouble. And so people say, you know what? I just don't want that in my church anymore. What you're saying is you don't want the Holy Spirit in your church anymore. I don't mean to be harsh, but that's to their own detriment. Usually what happens when a prophetic word comes, it's something that you already know is going on in your life. Right? The word that comes today, chances are you look at it and go, yeah, that's exactly what's happening. When Prophet Ed comes, and he'll be with us in a couple of weeks, if you pay attention, often what he does, he simply tells you something about your life. That's called word of knowledge, right? It's an insight, an understanding probably only you would know. It allows you to connect with the word. Now, word of wisdom, on the other hand, is the insight on how to handle the situation. Again, it's not a leading, it's light. So I know what to do, right? I know where I'm supposed to go. Sometimes the prophet will come and say, you're on the right path. You need to take the next step. You're gridlocked. You know you're gridlocked. It just helps you go to the next place. So the prophetic word is often confirming. Now, one of the ways that you as a believer can tell the difference between somebody who's genuinely operating in the prophetic and somebody who's kind of just a wannabe, the genuine prophetic will always encourage, lift up, and build up. From time to time, typically in the office of prophet, correction may come. Now, that's left to the office of prophet, typically. But even when correction comes, see, in the Old Testament, when the prophet brought correction, he brought a hammer, right? He just broke everything. Just boom, your life is a mess. The New Testament prophet, in the office of prophet, when he brings the hammer, it's a hammer that falls like a kiss. It's just, there's a sweetness to it. There's a, yes, I know. I mean, I do know. But I'm not rebuked or condemned by it. That is one of the great differences. So I just want you to know, Paul said, all can prophesy. He said, I wished all of you would prophesy. That was his intention. You find, all may prophesy in 1 Corinthians 14:31. The other thing he told the prophets, he said, when one prophesies, the other prophets should weigh carefully what's being said. You'll find that in 1 Corinthians 14:29. So, the proper way, when a word like this comes, the proper way is to give it to me so I can weigh it first, and Amy did that. And now, as she delivers the word, I want you also to weigh it. I want you to listen to the word and see what direction you find in it. Now, again, when I say direction, I'm not talking about we're going to follow Amy. What I'm talking about is God is going to reveal things and where they're at. And you will then take of those things and say, how is this helpful in me navigating my life? Things that are going on in the world and in the country and in the city and town and just in my own household. Sometimes what happens is when the prophetic word comes, it challenges us to an action. Well, that's good. But then I let the Spirit of God lead me in that action. Do you understand the difference? A little nodding somewhere. A little bit of nodding. I want you to understand. Because otherwise you can start following prophets, and then we just got a mess. Okay? All right. Somebody's awake. Amy, why don't you come?
Let's all stand. I really want to wait upon the Lord this morning, and we had a wonderful time in worship, but I just want to invite the presence of the Lord to come. And I want the Lord to only have his way. So Father, Holy Spirit, you are so good to us. And we invite your presence. We invite your presence to saturate us like we have never been saturated before. We invite your word to come upon us and to open our understanding at a deeper level of faith, a deeper level of revelation, a deeper understanding of the call of your body, your church, your ecclesia. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church in this hour. I know these are not my words, but Lord, these are your words, and I stand in the fear of the Lord this morning. I felt like Moses climbing up that mountain, scared to death, knowing that the Lord wants to speak to his people, and that the people need to hear the word of the Lord. So, Father, we thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you, God. And we love you and we praise you with all of our hearts. And we give you all the glory today. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. So I'm going to take you on a little bit of a journey. And forgive me, my voice is a little raspy. Back in October, and you know, we all get junk mail, and I sometimes just will get my mail and I just throw it on the counter. Well, back around October, and I don't know, I've signed up for different things before, and I just had let mail pile up on the counter, and I get all these envelopes, it seems like in the month of October, from different charities. And yeah, they're always wanting money. You give to one, and then they put your name on every mailing list. I mean, the political groups send you want money. You've got, I mean, all of them. And it's, you know, you want to give and you want to help, and you feel bad for the, you know, you feel really do. It's kind of hard, especially when you see the children at some of these different groups that are trying to reach. And it's very difficult. You know, you just can't give it all. Well, you can't give it all away, but you know what I mean. You can only give so much to help everyone. But and most of the time, I just throw it away. I pray. If I feel led, I'll give to this group, that group. But, and it's funny because I find it interesting that when these groups send you things, or send you, when they're wanting money, they'll send you like the gold coin or the nickel or a pack of socks or a pair of socks, or they'll send you, you know, whatever. It's funny. They're wanting money, but they're sending you a gift. And I think, well, don't, if you need the money, why are you sending me something? I don't know. I don't quite get that part. But one of the things I got that I thought was very interesting, and it actually spoke to me, was I got this little blue monthly, it's one of those calendars. It's a little monthly calendar. And when I opened it, it says in gold, it says, a year to remember, 2022. And when I read that, I said, yeah, 2022 is going to be a year to remember. Because you know what? We're tired of 2021. We went through 2020. We have been in 2021. I thought, oh, I can't wait till it's over. Now, this was like back in October. And I got excited, and I took a picture of it, and I sent it to my family. And I said, look, this is a prophetic sign. 2022 is going to be a year to remember. And I felt the weight on that. And I felt like the Lord was going to give me something about that. So last year, at this time, if you all remember, we were in the throes of the election, the whole January 6th had just happened. And I'm not getting political here, but there's some things we need to talk about, because we are at a crossroads in our nation. And if you have not figured that out, you're either living under a rock somewhere, or you are, I'm sorry, we're at a crossroads. We are at a crossroads as a church. I'm talking the body of Christ, the ecclesia, the children of God, the bride of Christ. We are at a crossroads in America. And so last year about this time, I, you know, if you all remember, I want to back up a little bit. You all remember, some of you that were coming at the time, I know we have a lot of new faces, and that's wonderful. But I stood up here, the first time I think I had ever spoke here, I started coming here in 2018. And the first time I ever really felt to give a word was in August of 2020. And I stood up here and I said, we have 99 days until November 3rd. And I was feeling this weight of prayer. I was feeling like we have really got to buckle down and pray. And that's when Joe asked me if I would start leading a prayer call on Friday. And so for the nation, for the election, and we started doing that. Me, Joe, Pastor Rod, sometimes Dale, Don, and I think some others have come in when they can. I know Friday mornings are hard. People work. It's at 7:30 in the morning. But we've been doing that faithfully for, well, since then. And so this time last year, when everything was happening and all the chaos was going on, the Lord had taken me to the story in 2 Samuel 15. And you don't have to turn there. I'm just going to read a couple verses, because this is a background to this word the Lord has given me for 2022. And it's the story of Absalom. And I'm just, it's 2 Samuel 15. I'm just going to read the first five verses. And it says, and I'm reading from the New Living Translation. It says, and after this, Absalom bought a chariot. Now, do y'all know who Absalom is? He was the fourth son of David. He was very good looking. He had this long, beautiful hair. He was very charismatic. He stood above everyone. He was just a really handsome guy. But he had
he had kind of been bashed out of David's, he'd done some bad things, and David didn't see him for a while. Absalom became very angry with his father, and he decided, you know what? I'm going to overtake my father's throne because I am better than my father, and I could run this country a lot better than my dad. So this is what it says. And after this, Absalom bought a chariot and horses, and he hired 50 bodyguards to run ahead of him. And he got up early every morning, and he went to the gate of the city. When people brought a case to the king for judgment, Absalom would ask in Israel where they were from, and they would tell him their tribe. Then Absalom would say, you've really got a strong case here. It's too bad the king doesn't have anyone to hear it. I wish I were the judge. Then everyone would bring their cases to me for judgment, and I would give them justice. Because I'm so great, I am so much better than the king, I would give them justice. And so he proclaimed this with great pride. And then the next verse says, when people that would come, they were supposed to go to the king, and then the king would make the decision of these cases. But instead, Absalom said, oh, I'll do it because the king, he's too busy. He doesn't have time for you, because I'll give you justice. And it says, when the people tried to bow before him, Absalom wouldn't let them because he knew he wasn't the rightful king. Instead, he took them by the hand and he kissed them, because he was trying to win their love. He was deceiving them. He was leading an insurrection in all of Israel against the righteous king, against the anointed king, God's king, who was David, the one that loved God with all of his heart, the one that made so many mistakes, the one who, after, you know, when he took out Uriah the Hittite and took Bathsheba, God said, the sword will never depart from your house, David. This is where this all started. Don't think the things you're doing in darkness, God does not see it. He does. And I say that out of the fear of the Lord today. If you have things in your life, get it cleaned up. It will cost you. The grace of God is greater. And yes, the grace of God continued with David. David repented and loved the Lord, and mercy's at the cross today. So I'm saying to you, if there are secret sins living within you, or you're doing things that you know you shouldn't be doing, repent and get them right before the Lord. And that is God. That is not me saying that. That was not part of this message. So it goes on and says, and I'm sorry, I'm a little stuffy, that he stole the hearts of the people of Israel. Now, in this translation, it says that Absalom did this for 4 years. In the King James Version, it says that Absalom did this for 40 years. Now, the Septuagint is the original translation. Is it the Greek? Hebrew to Greek, or anyway, the original translation says 40. It doesn't matter if it was 4 years or 40 years. Absalom went to the gate faithfully, persistently, to deceive the hearts of the nation of Israel. Now, when I got this message, and so that was last year at this time, and I was looking at all this election stuff, and I was angry, and we were all upset, and we knew what was going on. We're not stupid here. And I don't want to get into all that, because we've prayed and God's going to work all that out. But at the time when I got that planner, again, the Lord was taking me back to this. Well, back in October, at about this, well, let me go back. So I got the planner, and I told you the Lord was going to add to it. So a couple weeks before Christmas, I think it was maybe around Thanksgiving, the place where I work, and a lot of you know where I work, they send out an email, and they ask, because we're a nonprofit organization, they can't have money on the books, so they give out to other nonprofits, and they ask employees to nominate different charities that you want to see the company I work for give a large donation to, and they want you to And so then they take the top five. I really don't know how they do it. I think people nominate this and then they vote. They send another email out and then everybody votes to pick these top five charities. And I really, honestly, I just kind of zoom through those emails. My job is very busy and but this caught my eye and I'm going to show you something. So, and I'm sorry, I might go past 11:30. I hope everybody's okay with that. We have got to get out of a routine. This is a year to break a routine. We can't keep staying in a routine. This isn't drive-by Christianity. We've got churches all over the valley that run three services a morning, come in, sing, hear the message, leave. Come in, sing, hear. What is that doing? We've got to hear the voice of the Lord. If God wants to move, if the Spirit of God wants to break out, we've got to let Him break out. And we've got to get out of routine, church. We've got to do what the Lord tells us to do. If it's a prayer room in here at the end of a service, it's a prayer room. And if you don't feel like praying, then go home and go get coffee. You know, we've got to be sensitive to the Spirit of God. We are the church of the living God, and we have got to learn to flow in Him. So I'm apologizing now if I go past 11:30. So back to this email. So right when the Lord started giving me this, I got an email and it lists the top five charities they were giving to. And I say charities because when you hear this, you're going to see what I'm talking about. And a lot of the charities you would know, like St. Vincent de Paul, they did give to the food banks, different things like that. One of the charities, and I'm not going to name it. If you want to know about it, you can come and talk. Because we're not fighting people. We're fighting principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in high places. This is not about people. So please don't think I'm being mean and nasty. I'm not. I'm telling you, we're fighting powers that want to corrupt our nation and that want to corrupt our children. And this is a organization that's here in Phoenix. It's also around the country. And this is their vision. This charity envisions a world where all LGBTQ youth and young adults are embraced for who they are, actively engaged in their communities, and empowered to lead. Our mission is to serve LGBTQ youth and young adults ages 11 to 24. We enhance their lives by providing empowering social service programs that promote self-expression, self-acceptance, leadership development, and healthy life choices. That's what's sitting in the gate of Maricopa County. That's what's sitting in the gate in our children's lives and in our schools. We've got groups out there that are wanting to deceive our children. And just as Absalom wanted to tell, well, I'm going to give you justice. We've got these groups of organizations saying, oh, we'll give you justice. We'll give you peace. We'll accept you. You know, where was David? What happened to David? 40 years. Can you imagine 40 years? That's a long time. If that's an accurate translation, 40 years. Did David get so distracted that he didn't realize his own son was sitting in the gate of the city deceiving the people? You know, it only takes one person to cause all this chaos. So that's kind of the background. So the story goes on. Time went on. And so I said all that because we have this time where this chaos breaks out in Israel. And all of a sudden, we have David in a situation where he has to leave because Absalom has proclaimed himself king over Israel. And David flees and he leaves and the Bible says, it's really sad. It says as he's climbing out of Israel, he is weeping and crying, and people are weeping and crying with him. He's barefoot. He's in sackcloth. He has to leave Jerusalem. He has to abandon being king because his own son, his own flesh and blood, has overtaken his throne. So David ends up in a town called, and I'm going to try to pronounce it. It's called Mahanaim. Mahanaim. And that town means, and this is in 2 Samuel, I think it's like 18, 16, somewhere in there. I didn't write the verse down exactly where that's at. But if you want to read that story, if you want to start reading about Absalom, if you want to have some homework this afternoon, you can read 2 Samuel 15 through, this whole thing is going to go through chapter 20. So David is at this town, and the name of that town, Mahanaim, means two camps, the place of two camps. So this thing with David could have went one of two ways. Either David would totally have been gone as being king of Israel, and Absalom would have just taken over the entire nation, and that would have been it, and David would have lived there and died. Because he said, if the Lord sees fit, he'll bring me back to Israel. But he just said, I have to go. I have to get out of here. I'm going to be killed. And so David and his men fled there. So that's where we're at in America. We are at a place, and Rod said that at prayer Wednesday night. We are at a place where our nation is either going to go this way or we're going to go this way. And the church is at a very important time of where we're at. And I want to prove that out today. So we're at 2 Samuel 19. And in this story, back to chapter 18, it starts with Absalom. There's a battle, David's men. I'm not going to go through the whole thing. It starts with the opening of chapter 18 where they're fighting Absalom. At the end of chapter 18, Absalom is killed. Basically, his own pride takes him out because his hair got caught as David's men were chasing him. He was on his mule, and his hair, the biggest thing he was so prideful about, got caught in the branches of a tree, and his mule kept on going, and Absalom's dangling there, basically hanging himself. Joab comes along and kills, not at the king's command. The king, David, told him not to kill his son, but Joab did it anyway, and he killed him. So we're in chapter 19. David's mourning, he's upset. Joab gets upset because David's mourning. Finally, David gets back into sitting in the gate of this city. He's still in this town, and the people see, oh, okay, David's in the gate. You know, the people can come to him now. So then verse 15, David realizes that, you know, the people in Israel is like, well, Absalom's gone. We don't have our king. We need David to come back. So David's finally realizing, I need to get back to Jerusalem. I'm the king. You need to bring me back to my rightful place. So verse 15 in chapter 19 says, so the king returned and came to Jordan, and Judah came to Gilgal to meet the king and conduct him over Jordan. So Judah, the tribe of Judah, you know, David was from the tribe of Judah. The tribe of Judah meets him at Jordan. The 10 tribes of Israel come. They usher him across the Jordan River. He gets there. Everything's wonderful and fine, but it's not. All of a sudden, at the end, and I'm going to read this scripture. At the end of 2 Samuel 19, and I'm going to read this out of the King James. What happens is, now, Israel's just went through this terrible battle. There's been all this division. Absalom caused this insurrection. It's over. Absalom's dead. It's time to move on. But they don't. Because what happens is, guess what? Another division happens. It says that the men of Israel start fighting with the 10 tribes, start fighting with the tribe of Judah. And they start saying things like, well, you know, David, there's more of us. The 10 tribes say, well, there's more of us, Judah, than there is of you. And Judah's over here saying, yes, but David belongs to us because he's from the tribe of Judah. So they all get in this big argument. More division has come. And verse 43 says, and the men of Israel answered the men of Judah and said, we have 10 parts in the king, and we also have more right in David than ye. Why then did you despise us that our advice should not be first had in bringing back our king? And the words of the men of Judah were fiercer than the words of the men of Israel. And so they just got in this big argument. Where's David in all of this? David is silent. Now, why was David silent? You would think after just going through this horrendous battle with Absalom, He would have said, hey, guys, come on. Let's come together. Let's be in unity. Let's stop fighting. We're one nation under God. But he doesn't. He's quiet. He doesn't do anything. It could be, you know, he's just lost his son. He's battle weary. He's lived in a town that wasn't his own. He's probably still emotionally distraught. And who knows what was going on with David. Okay, 2 Samuel 20, verse 1. There happened to be there a man of Belial whose name was Sheba, the son of Bichri, a Benjamite. And he blew a trumpet and said, we have no part in David, neither have we inheritance in the son of Jesse. Every man to his tent, O Israel. So every man of Israel went up after David, went up from after David and followed Sheba, the son of Bichri. And the men of Judah clave unto their king from Jordan, even to Jerusalem. What in the world happened? What's going on? Where did this Sheba come from? Who is this man? Now, the scripture says he was a man of Belial. That word Belial, you can trace that clear back, I believe, to the sons of Belial. I looked this up a while back. Went clear back to the priests that Eli's sons were men, were sons of Belial. They were sons of wickedness. That word Belial means wickedness. So Sheba, this man, comes out of nowhere. He pronounces, hey, everybody, forget it. We're not going to follow David. Everybody, you just go to your tent. Get out of here. We don't want no part in David. But the men of Judah, they continue on. David goes back to Jerusalem. He takes care of some business. Now, what is division? That word division just means the act or process of dividing or separating. Here we are again. There's another division. You know, we have to get smart as a church. We've went through 2 years of all this division in our country. And the reason why I keep bringing up the nation, I'm a governmental intercessor. Everybody here has different callings in prayer. In the year 2000, the Lord mantled me to be a governmental intercessor. And it's a long story. But basically, I really didn't know how to pray. I didn't know, you know, what it meant to step into the Spirit and pray in the Spirit and pull down strongholds. And in the year 2000, we had built a new house that had a big walk-in closet. My daughter was a baby at the time. My husband worked day shift. And I would just feel this heaviness come upon me to go in that closet and sit and pray. And this was before the 2020 election, or excuse me, the year 2000 election. This was before 9/11. I had no idea what I was praying. I just felt this burden to pray. And I learned to step into the anointing of praying in the Spirit. You know, the scripture says, we know not what we pray when we pray in the Spirit, but you're praying the will of God. That's why it's so important to be filled with the Spirit, so that you can pray the will of God. Don't be afraid of being filled with the Spirit. It's the greatest thing. Be filled with the Spirit, because then you're praying. You're praying in the language of the Spirit. And so that's probably why I'm always drawn to these things. And so the Lord will share things with me. Sometimes I will just know the things in the Spirit before they even happen, because that's the anointing. That's the mantle that he's placed me with. And so when I got this story, I could just so see everything we've been through in 2 years. There's been all this division. There's been all this. I mean, we can name lists and lists and lists. We can go back and look at the Absaloms that's been in our nation for 40 years. We can go back to 1981 to now, and we can see all the things that have happened that the church should have been picking it up. But we were distracted. We were a distracted people. We were building bigger buildings, and we were, you know, building playgrounds, and we were not really doing what we should have been doing. And I'm not here to blame the church. It's a new day. It's a new era. God, the past is behind us. We're forgetting those things that are in the past, as Paul said, and we're looking forward. We're marching towards the high mark of the calling of Christ Jesus. It's a new day, and I'm excited. It's exciting because this is a year. This is going to be a great year. So David finally realizes, you know what? We got to do something. So, I got a drink. So, what he does, he calls for a man named Amasa. Now, Amasa had been Amasa is David's nephew. And he says to Amasa, hey, now Amasa had been Absalom's general. So David is taking Amasa. He's bringing him back. He's restoring him. He's forgiving him. I know you forsook me, Amasa, and you followed after Absalom, but I love you. You're my nephew. I want you to be my general. He said, we've got to get this Sheba because he's going to destroy this nation again. He's going to tear Israel apart. We've got to go into battle after Sheba. And he says, go out and come back and gather all the armies of Israel. Well, that was the first day. Then the second day. By the third day, Amasa had still not come back. Now Sheba's got a three-day, he's 3 days ahead. He's going all through Israel, and you can read through the scripture there, and he's telling everybody, he's putting all this division again against the king. So Amasa doesn't show up. So instead, David gets Abishai, and he says, Abishai, get over here. Joab, get over here. Get the armies of Israel together and go after this Sheba, this son of Bichri. Now, names in the Bible are always important. The name Sheba means seven or oath. And it also means son of Bichri. Now, I want you to catch this. The name Bichri means youthful. And if you keep burying it down in the Strong's, and I'm not going to give you all the numbers. If you want this study, I can email it to you or give it to Pastor Rod and he can send it out. But it says that word comes from a root word that means to bear early or new fruit. It's a youthful fruit. It's a new fruit, like the first fruit. So this Sheba, this Belial, this wickedness, this is a new division. This is a new problem. This is a new situation. We got to deal with the new situation. It's 2022. We've got to deal with new situations as a church. So, like I said, Amasa never showed up. Do you know what Amasa's name means? Amasa's name means burden. Names are significant. God just doesn't name names in the Bible. These names all have meanings. Now, a burden, when you're carrying a burden means a heavy load. That word burden means that, you know, you're causing something that's causing you to miss what the king's telling you to do. You're letting the distraction. You're letting you're letting something come between. You know, the Lord is speaking to all of us all the time. If he's telling you to do something and you're not doing it, it's stopping you from doing the work of the king. Amasa, it ended up costing him his life because when they went out, Abishai, Joab, and the armies of Israel, here came Amasa. He's 3 days late to the party. He's 3 days late to the battle. Joab took it upon himself and tricked him. And he went to give him a hug and a kiss. And instead, he took his dagger and slid it into his stomach and his guts spilled out onto the ground. And yeah, that's really graphic. Your disobedience will cost you everything. Don't let your disobedience, don't let your burden, your heavy load, your hobbies, your whatever. I mean, the pleasures of life, the television, movies. Don't let these things keep you from what the Lord is calling you to do, the battles he's wanting you to fight, the prayer, the times in prayer. There's times the Lord will just not let me go to bed until I've spent time in his presence. That's more important to me than 5 hours of sleep because I know if I'm obedient, he's doing something. And I want the Lord to do something. I want our nation saved. I want my family saved. God, don't let me go to sleep when you've called me to pray. So the story goes on, and Sheba is headed out. He gets up to a town in northern Israel and he gets to a place and it's called Abel Beth Makah. And he goes in that city and he hides. And this is 2 Samuel chapter 20. And he gets there, and then the armies of Israel come, and Joab builds a rampart, because, you know, all these cities are walled, and he takes that big battering ram, and they start to batter down the wall in the town of Abel Beth Maacah. And they're making all this racket. They're going to tear down that wall. They're going to get Sheba. All of a sudden, this woman, and here's the part, I've said this whole big long story to get to this part. A woman comes out of nowhere, and she hears all this, and she says to Joab, she says, Joab, hey, what are you doing? Now, I want to read this scripture. Let me find it here. It's verse 15 of 2 Samuel 20. Hold on. Let me make sure I'm at the right spot. It says, and Sheba passed through all the tribes of Israel to Baal Beth Maacah and through the entire regions of the Bichurites, who gathered together and followed him. So Sheba had picked up more followers, and they kept going. They get to that town. He's hiding out in there. Then verse 15 reads, all the troops with Joab came and besieged Sheba and Abel Beth Maacah. They built a siege ramp up to the city, and it stood against the outer fortifications. While they were battering the wall to bring it down, a wise woman from the city cries out to Joab to hear her words. She asks him to come to speak to her. Now, verse 17 says in the New King James Version, when she had come near to him, the woman said, she says to Joab, and he answered, and she says, are you Joab? And he answered, I am. And she said to him, hear the words of your maidservant. And he answered and said, I am listening. Now, the name of this woman is not given. It just says she's a maidservant. A maidservant is a female slave. A female slave in the book of Deuteronomy, the rules were for slaves and servants that you served your master 6 years, and in the seventh year, you could be released and be free. All you had to give was 7 years, and the seventh year, you would be set free, the end of 7 years. But if you loved your master and your master was good to you, the master would take your ear, put him, not most of you all know this story, we're seasoned Christians, but for those of you that don't, they would take your ear, put it on the door, take an awl, like a nail, and pierce your ear into the door, and you would wear like an earring to prove that you loved that master, and you were that master's servant. Well, that's what she was. That's what the church is supposed to be. We're supposed to be the servant of the Most High God. That meant we're listening. That was symbolical to, we have a hearing ear to our master, and we do what he tells us to do, and we go where he tells us to go because we're listening. And so here she is. She's a maidservant. Where's the town council? Nobody cared in the town council that somebody's out there beating down the gate of the city. No one cared. Where were the priests of the city? Nobody came. Where were the people that went in the synagogue, the rulers of the synagogue in that city? Nobody came out. Nobody cared but her. And she says to Joab, she's like, hey, this is a good town. And I'm going to kind of fast go through this. But she says, hey, this is a good town. Why are you trying to beat this down? She said, this is a city of wisdom. She says, I am among the peaceable and faithful in Israel. You seek to destroy a city and a mother in Israel. Why would you swallow up the inheritance of the Lord? Now, Joab was wrong. In the Old Testament, in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 10, 20, verse 10, it says that when they were to attack a city, they were supposed to let the city know they were first coming in peace. That's what they were supposed to do. It says, as you approach a town to attack it, you must first offer its people terms of peace. Well, Joab represented the government of David, and he didn't do it. Instead, he just thought, we're going to plow right through here, and we're going to go in there and get Sheba. But she was the only one that cared. So Joab says to her, well, the reason why we are here is that there's a man from the mountains of Ephraim, Sheba, the son of Bichri, He's raised up a hand against the king David. Deliver him only, and I will depart from the city. So the woman said to Joab, watch, his head will be thrown to you over the wall. Now, I want you to catch the spiritual application of this. The Old Testament, the Bible says, are types and shadows to bring us to Christ. There's stories in the Old Testament that reflect, like Pastor Rod talked about, where we are today. These are examples to us. These are spiritual applications. She was a female slave. She was devoted. We're the bride of Christ. We love our master. Our ears are pierced to hear his word. We are the intercessors of the Lord. We need to be awake and we need to see what is going on in the spirit. We're calling out to the Father. We've been faithful and we're saying, Lord, what is going on in our country? What is going on in our state? What is going on in our city, God? What is happening? And the Lord says to us, because Joab's name, this is so interesting. Joab's name, remember I told you names are important. Joab's name means Jehovah is Father. So this slave woman is crying out to Jehovah is Father. And she's saying, why are you trying to tear down my city? I didn't do anything wrong. And Joab is saying, the father is saying, but there's a sin. There's a man, a Belial. There's a Sheba. There's a son of Bichri. He's there in your city. He's there to, and he's going to bring more wickedness to your city. And she's like, all right. We're going to tear this down. It's not going to be me. It's going to be all of us. Church, it's all of us doing the word of the Lord this year. This is going to be the word of this is what the church is going to do this year. We've went through 2 years of turmoil in our nation. This is going to be a year to remember, 2022. This is the church's finest hour. I don't think there's ever been an hour in the earth. Who knows? I'm going to be bold enough to say it since the day of Pentecost. There's going to be great and mighty things happen, but there's also going to be the church rising up and doing what we're called to do as a people. I'm not going to say it's going to be easy. It's not. Cutting off someone's head. Can you imagine what that was like? Go ahead, Beverly, pull up that scripture. When the Lord gave me this, and I'm almost done. Oh, can you make it a little bigger? Chris, can you come up and sing that second song? Because, boy, when you guys were singing that, this is how I fight my battles. And I'm sorry. Is everybody okay? Is it too late? I know we all want coffee and Starbucks and... I'm sorry, but I'm not sorry because I carried this burden for a month of delivering this word. Now, isn't this interesting? Then the woman went unto all the people in her wisdom, in her wisdom. See, we just can't do things willy-nilly. We are a church that needs to seek the wisdom of God in everything that we're doing in prayer. That's what's been so great about Wednesday night prayer. Pastor Rod is teaching us to listen for the Spirit of God, teaching us to wait on the Spirit of God. That's what he's teaching us. So after we get done with worshiping, we're waiting, we're listening. Lord, what is your direction? We just can't willy-nilly go cut somebody's head off. Now, I'm talking, we're not literally going to cut people's heads off. This is a spiritual application. This is spiritually. It says, and they cut off the head, they, not her, they cut off the head of Sheba, the son of Bichri, and cast it out to Joab. And he blew a trumpet. That means the battle was over. And they retired from the city, every man to his tent. And Joab returned to Jerusalem unto the king. Now, when the Lord gave me this, I went into such intercession because look at this. It's 2022. It's 2022. Do you feel the anointing on that? Because I am feeling it right now. This is our word for the year, church. We're going to see a mighty harvest in America. We're going to see souls come through this door. We are going to see our country saved. We are going to see evil destroyed. And it may not all happen this year. I'm not going to say, but it could. We are on the beginning
of a mighty revival. And I know today's been different, but it's a new day. It's 2022. It is a day of great and mighty things are coming. And I'm just going to end up, Beverly, put that picture up, please. Some of you have probably seen these pictures before, but man, this is who we are. We're the bride. And we are bowed down in a place of humility with a sword of the Spirit in the shape of a cross. And we have ourselves firmly on the blood of Jesus at our, under our feet, under us. But we wear combat boots because we are not afraid. We are not afraid. So church, I just thank you that you are my brothers and sisters. I thank you for what God's doing in our life. I thank you for where he's taking us this year. And Lord, above all, we give you the praise and we give you the glory and we give you the honor. For we are that female maidservant who will cut off the head of the enemy and throw it over the wall. The government cannot save America. We know that. Lord, we only know that you and your church rising up, hearing your voice, doing your will. God, we thank you that we are your bride and we will hear your voice and do your will. In Jesus' name, let's sing that song.
Thank you. So here's the word. Sons of evil, bits of evil, have taken refuge in different places. There's sons of evil in the government. There's sons of evil in the city. There's sons of evil in our own lives. There are Shebas that have taken up residence in our life. And it's our job to take their heads and throw them over the wall. That's the word. Don't be surprised if God begins to point out Shebas in your life. And if you want to deal on a higher level, when we start talking about principalities and powers and things in the government, things like that, that we do as a group on Wednesday nights, right? That is something we do together. In your own life, though, God will point out things for you. So, Chris, why don't we just do that song again or whatever one you've prepared? I don't want to miss communion. Communion is an important part of who we are. So, Chris will do a song. Rod, why don't you come?
Well, this morning I was going to say a few words about the fruit of the Spirit, but it's one of those days when this morning and as I was there before God said, nope, you're just going to talk about one of them. So I think there's probably somebody here who needs to hear about this since it's been a theme that's kind of been resonating through our whole service, and that is peace. If you want to read about all the seven fruits of the Spirit, they're in Galatians chapter 5. You can go home and do that. I would encourage you to. But one of the great gifts, and the world doesn't have it, but God gives it to us, is peace. In the midst of turmoil and chaos and just things seeming all topsy-turvy, This is going to be an eventful year. I can see it. I have a year of victory, but it's going to be an eventful year. And in that, we can have peace. We can rest in Him. Philippians 4, 6, and 7 says, have no anxiety about anything. That's a command. It's not a suggestion. It's a have no anxiety about anything, but by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And then there's a promise. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. We can do that. Just make our request known to God and leave it with him. Isaiah 26:3 says, "Thou dost keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusts in thee." Why? Because he trusts. And that's important. We have to have faith. We have to trust him. First Peter 5:7 says, "Cast all your anxieties on him, for he cares about you." It was interesting, the song that we sang, and we actually sang it twice, but the song by Phil Wickham, The Battle Belongs, there's a line in there, "Every fear I will lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. The battle belongs to him." So I would encourage you, if you're struggling with something, if this turmoil in your life, if this anxiety, put it at the foot of the cross. Leave it. And don't pick it back up again. If you're going to lay it at his feet, don't go and say, "Well, I don't really trust. I need to," because then you're trusting in yourself, and you take on that anxiety again. Now, we're commanded not to have no anxiety about anything. So, on to the service, the communion. On the night that he was betrayed, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he gave the bread to his disciples. He broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in memory of me." When the supper was ended, he took the cup. Again, he gave thanks and praise and gave the cup to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is my blood, which will be given for you. Do this in memory of me." Father God, we just thank you for the wonderful power of the blood, the peace and the gifts that you give us, the great benefits package that comes with walking with you. We love you, God, and just pray that you will use us and that you'll position us and that you'll do your work through us in this year, and that this would be a victorious year for each person here, God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, it's been quite a morning. I hope you're going to go home full. It's my hope. Father, I dismiss your people now. In peace, in Jesus' name. Father, go before them. May your anointing be upon them. Father, may your signs and wonders follow them. Father, I ask that you would speak to their hearts. I pray, Father, that you'd make their path clear. Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. I also want to encourage you, if you would like prayer this morning, there's a great prayer team, but they're not going to come find you. You need to come up here, right? And if you're a little awkward about that, just grab and say, "Can we go somewhere else?" But the prayer team is here to pray for you. So if you'd like, if you're on the prayer team, just raise your hand. Don, Joe, who else? Oh, Heather's not here today. So grab somebody and be prayed for. Have an awesome week.